Welcome back. This is True Believers in the Road to Hell. We're talking with Martha Vazquez, Federal District Judge in Santa Fe. This podcast is entitled, as you said earlier, True Believers in the Road to Hell. And probably the answer is, I hope, obvious, but I want to make sure that you feel like you fit within the definition. Are you a true believer? You consider yourself a true believer?
In what sense?
Oh, do you have a passion about which you about which you operate, that you pursue?
I'm very passionate about certain aspects, yes.
Like what?
I'm very passionate about my work. I'm very passionate about what I do, about the importance of the work that a lot of people involved in our legal system do.
I wonder what your aspirations are now. What are your aspirations today, 28 years in, as compared to 28 years ago?
Well, now that I'm looking at, I guess I'm looking at wrapping up, taking senior status. It's very important to me that the judge that takes my place be very committed to the job that we do here. It be very committed to all the needs of our people. And we have such a huge criminal caseload. And it involves so many aspects of a person. Now that we are permitted to look at all aspects of an individual. And I think to do it well requires so much time be given to every case, so much reading be done, so much thought be given. You can do it well without doing all, you can just read the script that is provided to you by probation and not really do a whole lot more, but.
Are your goals different now than they were? Have you changed over the years?
No, I don't think my goals are any different. I'm much more weighed down by everything I've seen.
I take you mean it takes a heavier toll on you than it used to? Is that what
it
you mean?
It does take a heavier toll. I've seen the ramifications of my decisions. I've seen the toll that it's taken on the individuals I've sent to prison. I've seen them afterwards. I meet with them afterwards. So I've seen what it's done to their families. So that's what I mean.
What is it that drives you to continue?
I like to think that I bring what Father Hesburgh used to say is absolutely critical to the profession. I bring compassion and competence. But I also bring what I was taught by all my mentors at the public defenders. I bring a very strong work ethic. I continue to work every evening. I read and I read and I read. And every weekend, I read everything that is filed by the lawyers in every case. I pride myself in being very prepared, and I read it in advance so I have time to think about what the right decision is.
And you've done that throughout your career, right? So
I have.
I don't think that it sounds like, given that, you really wouldn't change anything over the last 28 years. I'll just ask you, is there anything you'd change about what you've done and have regrets about having done certain approaches or certain things over the years, or are you pretty satisfied with
Well, I think it's hard to ask a woman that, a mother, because I do have regrets. I mean, I'm divorced. My children suffered the absence of their mother when they were too young. This job, I used to laugh and say that there's a good reason why most of the judges in 1993 were older white guys with gray hair. It's because their children were gone, their children were older. You know, they had somebody like their wives taking care of children. I mean, it was a rough time for me to have assumed this very important, somber role. So do I regret? I do regret that it came at a time when I was so needed by my children. So what do I do now in my life? I am seriously thinking about trying to be the grandmother that my mother was now.
How many grandchildren do you have?
I have 8.
Wow.
And I don't want to wait, Michael, till I'm 80 or 90. I want to be able to have an influence like my mother had and like my grandparents had in my life, where things that are important to me, I am able to be able to impart in their lives, my values, my goals. You know, speaking Spanish is important to me. And, you know, the values that our family for generations have had, I want to be able to be in their lives, not just for Christmas and Easter. You know, I want to have time to spend with them and make up for what I didn't give my children because my job was so important for the lives of, you know, those we serve. So, you know, it's hard to do it all and it's hard to have it all and it's hard to be there for everyone. And so I am thinking about leaving and spending, you know, chunks of time with all of them. They're all different parts of the country and world, but, you know, it's hard to do this job and be a meaningful presence in the lives of my children. And they're at the stage in their life right now that we were when we were doing litigation. You know, they need help raising their children, like I needed help raising mine. And so I can give back to them now and give back to their children by helping and, you know, cooking for my grandchildren. And
the essence of your generosity just seeps through. I mean, you're so generous.
No, I had that. I lived that.
I understand, but I mean, you're giving that, you're doing it for all the right reasons, and just, you're just, I don't know, I'm sorry, I don't mean to
and the other thing that
flatter you, but it's just, you just show that generosity throughout, but go ahead.
What I see in my cases that breaks my heart is that so many of the people that come before me don't have that. You know, they've either raised themselves, you know, as children for a variety of reasons, whether it's poverty or mental health or whatever. But the lack of so many important things have had such drastic and painful effects in their lives. And I read about that every night of my life. And it's so sad for me that I'm young enough to be able to provide so much of what I love. You know, when I wasn't able to do it, my children, as I told you, were so little when I came on the bench. And it's not going to be easy for me to leave because as hard as this job is, as draining emotionally as it is, I love what I do.
When you talk about leaving it, are you talking about going on senior status, or are you talking about leaving or retiring? Because I don't quite understand exactly what senior status means sometimes.
Well, I'm taking senior status first, and that'll be in December.
Okay.
And then after that, at some point after that, not too far into the future.
So after the grandkids.
I do want a different life for me. I want to go, I'm going camping with them on the beach in a week, and I do that often with them, and I want more of that. I want that kind of lifestyle for me and them.
I certainly hope you achieve that, because you're obviously I've kind of seen the history of your life here this afternoon. I can see you were a wonderful daughter and granddaughter, and a wonderful grandmother as well, with that heart. I'm wondering, in terms of when you were talking about your role as a woman, that's such a huge issue. We don't have time to deal with it completely or fully, of course, but I'm just wondering your take on whether those impressions and those attitudes and that treatment has improved over the years. I mean, it's because women have been traditionally, historically, they've had to meet greater challenges than white men in particular in order to get to achieve things. And there's obviously a lot of social movement and on that issue, but I'm wondering how much improvement you think there is. You're talking about, we were talking off of the recording about you being disrespected or being shown disrespect in court sometimes. And it was a question, I guess, was that a sexist disrespect, or was there something else going on or whatever? But so I'm wondering what your take is on that. And I understand it's unfair and that it's such a huge issue, but maybe you've experienced whether there's improvement or not.
It's very difficult to be the subject of that. It's very humiliating for some reason.
To be shown the disrespect you
right.
mean.
Can you
tell us, whoever's listening, and maybe just you and me, but what is the disrespect we're talking about in general?
Well, when you feel it, you may not always know why or why it's happening or what it is exactly. Is it your gender? Is it your race? When you grow up as a woman of color, it's something that you grow up with. It's something that happens to you in your life. It's something that it's not an uncommon experience. I have experienced it repeatedly in my life.
You have experienced what repeatedly?
Being treated disrespectfully because of sexism or racism, being called names.
Really?
Over the years, I heard my father disrespected. I was present when my father was disrespected. I saw him recoil. I think it was because we were watching. I grew up seeing him be so proud, as he had every reason to be, because he was so hardworking, but also seeing kids laugh at him because his English was spoken with a thick accent, and they pretended not to understand and make fun of him. I came to New Mexico when, at a time when being called Mexican was a bad word. I was so stunned by that. My parents made it a point that all of us grow up being very proud of being Mexican and being from a beautiful country of Mexico. And my grandparents were from this village in Mexico. And I was stunned when in New Mexico, everybody wanted to be Spanish and nobody wanted to be Mexican. And I love Santa Fe, and Mexican food was called Spanish food, but everybody loved Mexican music, loved mariachis. But it was so perplexing to me. I was called a spic in Indiana one time when I was on an airplane. Those things are things that are prevalent in our country. But as a federal judge, when you feel that kind of treatment in the courtroom, it very much catches you off guard. Partly because you're in a courtroom, and as a first generation American citizen, you have this incredible faith in our Constitution and devotion to our Bill of Rights, and you're enshrined in all of it when you're in our courtrooms. And so, it's such a shock. And then you feel so humiliated, and my cheeks get red, and what I'm talking about is examples of just disrespect, where everyone turns to look at this person, that it's so obvious to everyone, it's not just you imagining something, where my law clerks are shocked, where they talk about it, where everybody wants you to do something about it, and you have to step back and realize that you have to be careful about how you handle it, and you have to be judicious. It's not a good word.
To coin a phrase. No. Well, can you clarify or give any more detail about what it was that happened?
Well, very early in my career, I was handling.
I mean, in terms of this incident being shown disrespect.
Yeah, it was very early in my career, and it was a very important case, and a lawyer wouldn't abide by a ruling, and he wouldn't stop talking. And there were a lot of people in the courtroom. And, I'd been practicing enough years to know what you do when a judge makes a ruling. You sit down and you abide by it. You can make your showing. You can do whatever you need to do, lay your record, whatever you're entitled to. But the time comes when you stick with it and you abide by it. And this lawyer wouldn't abide by it. He kept asking the same question, kept doing the same thing. Opposing counsel was stunned, and even his co-counsel was stunned, and I was stunned, and I had to keep telling him what the ruling was again and again and again. And it was like I wasn't there, like I didn't count, like my ruling meant nothing.
And if you were a white man, it'd have been a different situation.
Oh, I mean, I honestly, as a lawyer, can't imagine treating anybody that way or not abiding by the ruling, no matter who the judge was. But I was shocked about that. Well, that didn't just happen once. It kept happening. It was astounding to me.
With the other lawyers or this?
With that lawyer.
The same lawyer.
With that lawyer, right. Mm-hmm. You know, and it hasn't just happened that once. It has happened, thankfully, not often, but it has happened several times. It happened more at the beginning. Part of it may have been that I was a woman and nobody was used to that. Part of it may be that I'm pretty soft-spoken. I don't know, but it happened at the beginning quite a bit. And then it hadn't happened for a long time, and then it has started to happen again more recently. I mean, I would come into chambers and my law clerks would be stunned, just stunned, which would make me feel even more humiliated.
Because they felt it too.
They felt it too.
Yeah.
My staff, you know, your staff is in the courtroom taking minutes and, you know, checking microphones and doing all that stuff. And they would all be insulted too, and which would make it worse for me. It would make me feel even more embarrassed and humiliated. And I don't know why I would be humiliated, but I always felt humiliated by it. Just like the very first time it happened, I remember, was in Indiana. I mean, because I grew up with other Mexican immigrant families in California, so I wasn't exposed to people calling me names until I left the cocoon in which I was raised. And I flew for the first time to Indiana to start my freshman year. And I was first exposed to the United States at large. And I was first called, I had never even heard the word Spick, Mike. I didn't even know I was being insulted, you know, until the reaction from the general public was like, you know, and it was when I was first exposed to living outside of my cocoon. And that's when I, you know, and that's when it started. And that's when I first started experiencing, because from then I'd never left my family except go to Mexico to live with my grandparents, and I was back with my family, so I'd never experienced that.
I think that most people would think that it's your description, your narrative of this is especially surprising in a federal courtroom, you know, because you think of, as you say, just doesn't matter. That's the judge, and you might be out of fear or out of respect, but you do what the judge says, right? And so it really says something that someone is able to disrespect you that way, so conspicuously, and as here you are. The federal judge, in addition to everything else, it's just that's a surprising, or maybe not surprising. It's a fascinating story, and I'm sorry that happens to you. I'm wondering do you think that situation in obviously, if you're a federal judge, you wish that, well, I'm a federal judge, I can just order that not to happen, right? Or I can order the society or my jurisdiction to not be sexist or racist, but of course you can't. But aside from that, what do you have suggestions on what can improve those situations?
Well, I think we're moving in the right direction in some respects in our legal system, in that I know that several judges around the country have been very involved in trying to teach us as judges and lawyers about how we all have these biases. We all like to think that we are, you know, very good people and we're kind people, and we wouldn't ever think of ourselves as racist. But, you know, I've attended several things recently in which we do these tests, you know, and, mm-hmm. and of course, I think they're invaluable in making us realize that, of course, we all have, you know, what is now become so commonly known as these unconscious biases.
Right.
And it's very important that we catch ourselves and that we be aware of this. Because, you know, I've started showing this video to all of my jurors. It doesn't matter what kind of case I'm doing it.
From Washington, I think.
Washington State, right?
Right,
yeah. But I think it's just important for all of us to be aware, not just jurors, but all of us to be aware, because the fact is that lawyer or those lawyers that have behaved that way in the courtroom, I don't know whether they were intentionally trying to insult me. Maybe not, but I think that they're feeling that it was all right to act that way, or because I didn't look like the typical judge that they had always practiced before of, so it was okay to behave that way. I just think we need to be aware. We just need to be aware, and it encompasses all of our lives. Whether we're talking about eyewitness identifications or whatever it is that we're talking about, I think it is important to be aware that that's how we instinctively behave sometimes. And it hurts people's feelings, and it can cause tremendous damage.
I've seen the video that you're referring to, that I believe the same one, on unconscious bias, and I've seen other presentations on that. Do you think that is helpful to the... You show it to the jury panel, right? And what effect has that had?
Well, I've heard it discussed during voir dire, and I think it's very thought-provoking. I've heard jurors comment on how thought-provoking it has been for them.
Is there one side or the other that objects to showing such a video?
I've had the government object to showing it.
What's the objection?
Well, they've said either that it's not relevant. I think that's really the objection, is that it's not relevant.
It's hard to get more relevant, it seems like. But
I think whatever the case is, whether I don't see the harm in any case, a guy just showed it in a case involving an African-American victim and an African-American defendant, you know. I've shown it with Native Americans. I've shown them with white defendants. It doesn't matter. I just think it's important that we all be aware. So I show it in all my cases.
Would it be fair to say that on a little hint of optimism that is some improvement, is awareness on these issues at least? Obviously, we've got a huge way to go on sexism and racism, and they're huge social issues, but the unconscious bias training and other programs are at least helpful and step in the right direction.
Mm-hmm. I think we have to broaden it, though. You know, we have so many Native Americans in New Mexico, and in federal court, we have so many of our cases involve crime in Indian country. You know, that I'll tell you something that Judge Burciaga told me when I first came on the bench. And he said that one of his jurors told him, or wrote him a letter, I don't remember, many years after a trial that he had with them, and it was obviously a crime in Indian country case, that he felt he should have reported right after, and he didn't. And, you know, that wasn't a case. No voir dire in federal court. You know, this was Judge Burciaga's cases, and it was early 90s, maybe late 80s, I don't remember. But the juror reported that one of the conversations the jurors had during deliberations was that you can't believe these Indians because you know they're all drunk. And there was evidence of intoxication that was introduced. Evidence of a victim being drunk and evidence that the defendant had something to drink. And so basically the jurors were saying, they're all drunk, you know, Indians are always drunk. And, you know, that's a perfect example of, one, why we need more Native Americans on the jury, but two, this implicit bias thing. You know, I mean...
That's just a stereotype. That is,
yeah, but you need to talk about that. Right. You should voir dire about it. You know, but a lot of people have that point of view. A lot of people think that. And so the witness's testimony were all disregarded without any evidence of whether everybody had been intoxicated at the time. And that juror reported it, unfortunately, many years later to Judge Burciaga. And that's something that I always tell, you know, lawyers about, or tell lawyers to voir dire about life in Indian country. And it has always really troubled me that the importance of voir dire about jurors having certain thoughts that they don't reveal. And then things will come up during jury selection about racist views. And it haunts me. It haunts me that that effect in that case was something that could have been avoided.
It also seems to me to be a, maybe I'm leaping a little here, but it seems to me to be a good reason why you want to have good voir dire. And of course, you know, you know that's a pet issue.
Absolutely.
You want to have those discussions before the jury deliberations.
Yeah, absolutely. So. Especially, you know, in federal court where we have so many cases that occur in Indian countries, in Indian country, which is so remote and so different from regular urban life from which most of our jurors come from.
I don't know the numbers on that. How many cases do you have in roughly in that are from Indian jurisdiction?
We have a lot of them. I can't tell you what the numbers are, but we have a lot of our cases occur in Indian country, whether there's assault and batteries or rapes or murders or vehicular homicides or whatever.
And do you have an adequate number of natives in the jury panel?
No, I don't think so. And partly it's because of, partly because our jury plan is based on voter registration. And it's not just the Navajo Nation, but all of our Native American communities, you know, well, not all of them, because our pueblos, of course, aren't remote. But, you know, Michael, they're very rural. And there's great distances, and people have very limited access to transportation, and the roads are in terrible shape. So registering to vote is very, very difficult for many people. And that's why they don't register to vote, so they never get on our jury panels, on our jury pool.
Yeah. Well, it'll take some doing, but the feds ought to do what several states have done in broadening their jury panel pools to begin with. But
that's another issue for another time.
Another issue for another day. So, well, there's so many things that you can shed light on, and you are, I just admire you so much, and you're such an inspiration. And I hope that you do get to do everything you want with your with your job and your grandchildren.
Thank you.
And appreciate you taking the time here today, and so much. So thank you, and good luck to you.
Thanks, Michael. I appreciate the time we spent together.
All right, that's be the end of this segment of True Believers in the Road to Hell. Thank you.